Okay, so it's 2 minutes past the hour, so I think we can go ahead and get started, and anyone who's a little bit late can just jump on in when they can. And of course, I will say this, we will be sending out the recording of the webinar after, so feel free to join anytime and drop if you need, come back. We will be sending out the recording afterwards. All right, so once again, thank you for joining our webinar, Transforming the Traditional Way of Analytics. Shlomi Oshik Avioz, who is with me on the webinar, will be controlling the slides. So let me ask you to move on, Oshik. Great, so just a very quick introduction of myself, Oshik, and what we're gonna be talking about today. So very quick overview, my name is Talia Schmidt. I head up the marketing for All Cloud in EMEA. Like I mentioned, with me is Oshik Avioz. He's our chief data architect here at All Cloud, and he will be talking about transforming the traditional way of analytics. Slide, please. So what you'll learn by joining this webinar, the very first thing is how to leverage AWS to build a scalable, serverless, end-to-end data and analytics platform, which is really, I think, a key here and a core reason of why everyone joined. The second is how to unlock business value from existing data, and then we're gonna look at how to visualize and analyze your data, then go into how to reduce the time of building data lakes or pipelines from months into a very short amount of time of weeks. And then Oshik will go into a live demo. Very quick overview of All Cloud. Seconds, All Cloud is a global, we have 7 global operating centers in which we provide services for cloud platforms and infrastructures. So we help our clients with their big cloud projects, and we have over 3,000 successful deployments. We have over 250 cloud experts, and of course, we have over 300 AWS and Salesforce certifications. Slide, please. We have over 150 AWS certifications. Specifically, I think I'll call out for this webinar, certifications in big data and machine learning. We're also an AWS premier partner. Slide, please. And this is just a very brief overview of our sample client list. So you can go ahead and look at that. And of course, we have a demo for you today with our client Ilminda, who's mentioned up here. Slide, please. And with that, I'll hand it over to Oshik, who will talk about transforming the traditional way of analytics. Take it away, Oshik.
So thanks, Talia. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining. We are really excited to have everyone connected around the globus. So hopefully you are all doing well, and let's hope to get there through this situation with coronavirus mm-hmm. and soon as possible. So thanks for taking the time, and you know, good morning, folks. Good morning, afternoon, and good morning, good evening. We have a lot of unfilled jam package agenda for you today. Yeah, we are going to learn a lot. We are going to see a great demo, and I hope you guys all are all excited. So my name is Oshik Avioz, and I'm a Chief Data Architect at All Cloud. So before we begin this webinar, I wanted to start with some housekeeping items. So at the end of this webinar, we'll have a 10-time Q&A, but you know, of course, if you don't get to all of them, so I have added some contact information, so you can always reach out to use and we'll answer all of questions for you guys. Okay, here is a quick review of what we're covering today. So we'll look at the summary motivation behind why our organization are looking at data lake. So there's some concept and principle around designing data lakes. what does a data lake on AWS look like? So we, also a common questions and challenges we get asked when we meet our customer in field as we embark on this journey. Some design pattern of data lake use case and a pipeline to count these challenges actually. Of course, we'll add some security constraint and secure governing your data lakes in efficient manners. And then at the end of, we are going to see a quick technical demo on how to use a key component of AWS data, and finally, a Q&A. So why data lake? You can store your data lake as is without having a fair structure, say the data, and run different type of analytics from dashboard and visualizations to big data processing, real-time analytics and machine learning to get better decision. As we see, organizations that successfully generate business value from their data will outperform their peers. So today, we can see organizations who implemented data lakes outperforming similar companies by 9% organic revenue growth. This lead, they were able to do a new type of analytics like machine learning of a new source like logs file, data from clickstream, social media, and IoT connected device stored in data lake. This type of data mostly lock in organizations. And today, thanks to big data solution, we can have it. So this helped them to identify and at the open opportunities for business go faster by attracting the retaining customer, boosting productivity, proactivity, maintaining devices, and making informed decision. Well, there are more data than people think. As we all know, data sets are getting bigger. And they are all coming from various different sources, different diverse of sources like applications, like CRM, like ERP, social media, and many other different applications. And they are all going into their own silos. And the velocity of which data is coming is also going really fast with machine generated data and logs going faster than business. When we build a data platform, we need to keep in mind that platform need to survive a long period of time, like typically around 15 years. And so when we build something, say, you know, a data platform, we need to think about not only its today needs, but also the needs are going to fulfill for the next 15 years. So with this assumption that we know the data grow 10 times typically in 5 years. So we need to build something that can scale to some time in 15 years. As of course, there are some people accessing data and more equipment of making this data available for many organizations. So would like to access data with their business aspects. So that's like talking about, you know, how to run their business report and you know, to run their ad hoc analytics and to run their machine learning model. And they would like to flexibility to self and put this data, run real-time analytics, or run massive scale queries. So at the same time, they need to take care for all security and compliance requirements. So breaking that due to the next level, what does the actually data lake on AWS actually look like? So the fundamental central part of it is there in the middle of the screen is Amazon S3. So S3 is the foundation of all data lakes on AWS. Just because you have data on S3 doesn't make it a data lake. So, but you know, it does become the foundation data, you know, that put your data in and start to build the data lake on top of it. So SLOS was designed for scale. So there's many security features built for it. We'll talk about them later on this webinar. And finally, SLOS is very, very inexpensive. Now get data into S3, there is a number of mechanisms. So you can bulk log your data using Amazon Snowball or Amazon Snow Mobile. You can stream your data using streaming services such as Kinesis or Kafka. You can simply do a S3 copy using a CLI or SDK or even VPN or Direct Connect. So let's say if you have an OLTP databases, so you can migrate this using DMS, Database Migration Services. And finally, you can also leverage hybrid storage solutions like the storage gateway to seamlessly migrate your data into S3. And once you have the data in S3, it is important to catalog and search the data. So then when you have this come to the picture, DynamoDB and Elasticsearch. So this is accomplish this and explain in later. However, with the launch of AWS Glue, you can now discover an enforced schema that has been created automatically for you. So you can start working on your analytics, and we'll see this in this demo. You can also leverage tools like AppSync, like API Gateway, so to provide access and UI to your data lake using Cognito for sign in or sign out, of course. And of course, the security is a pivotal to everything in AWS. And doesn't it, you know, and it is the same for all data lake that you built on AWS. So as you can manage data lake using a number of security controls, so they have on the platform such as AWS key management system service, or like identity and access management, IAM, of course, CloudWatch and CloudTrail to monitor and log your activity. With all this being done for all one purpose, actually. So there is many hybrid of tools in the analytics aspect that you can see in the right side, so that you can leverage to process and consume your data in the data lake. So this include Amazon Athena, EMR, Redshift, as well as Redshift Spectrum and platform and other platform that you can use on AWS. Well, now that we have an overview of what data lakes look like in AWS, so we have come to define some key concept of attribute of what data lake should have actually. And so you should think about it as data lake is where all data is in one place. So and save as a single source of truth of all your analytics needs. So the data lake has the ability to handle structured, semi-structured, or even raw data. It has to be inexpensive, of course. So to support a schema on read, also support decoupling of storage and compute so that you have freedom of these two resources. Of course, security, as I said, is critical to everything on AWS. So you want a data asset and the resource accessing that the data must be secure as possible, of course. So in that, let's see how customer building and designing data lakes today. Let's get some common question and challenges that we encountered when we meet our customers. And I am sure that we have recent in our situation as well. Okay, so there is some of this question that we are getting from the customers. So let's say, how can I do streaming ingestion into the data lake? Can data lake replace our database replica? How to organize data inside the data lakes? How to handle late events coming into old partitions? And how to perform update and delete on the data lakes? And there is a lot of subset of questions that we can imagine. So let's see how we can address this concerned question using some example from design pattern that we have seen. Actually, you know, the pipelines, you know, let's talk about actually the data pipeline use case. So that the pipeline help you do reliable process and move data between different AWS compute and storage services, as well as an on-premise data sort at specified interval. So you can regularly access your data where it's stored, transformed, and processed it at scale, of course, and efficiently transfers the result to AWS services such as Amazon S3, Amazon RDS, DynamoDB, and Amazon EMR, of course. So let's say about common use cases. So we may have different use cases in your environment that just for the purpose of this presentation. So we will consider like, you know, logs or clickstream analytics or even processing IoT data use cases. So let's say you have an application that is streaming the data to Kinesis firewalls, as we can see in these pictures. And that data is designed for S3 because you configure firewalls to deliver it to S3 bucket. And then from S3 bucket, you can save in each data to even need to analytic tools like Athena, like Presto EMR, and Redshift Spectrums. Or even Redshift, Redshift that copy the need to the Redshift cluster for data warehouse cluster. But however, there is a problem. So you might end up there with too many files. So as you can see, there is the most potential problem with when you work in was big data analytics. So too many files, which is not necessary in optimized analytic for this. So it could happen because, let's say, IoT sensor data is tiny and many configure and buffering tool well. And the Kinesis firewalls actually is to be smaller, like 1 minute or 2 minute. And you are not gathering the data for fit it because it's a reasonable in size file. So there is how to we address actually this problem. So here's what you can do in AWS Data Lakes. You can follow this approach of streaming the data into Kinesis firewalls. Okay, so and then however you can set the data into tier one, which is S3 bucket, which is a place where we house the data as raw data actually, and then use a Glue ETL job, okay? So to perform hourly compaction and then converting from a ERC or Parquet, for example, and put this data into a S3 bucket for tier two, okay? And then serve your data into tier two to all of this analytic and to serve this as a, for all this service analytic they can choose in AWS analytic platforms. What about use case where you need to fast ingestions? In this case, you can still configure Kinesis firewalls to deliver to Redshift cluster, and then, or instead directly to S3, okay? So there the frequency basis of periodically basic, so you can have a glue job to convert to Redshift cluster and perform the ETL to put process to data S3. And then you can Amazon Redshift Spectrum, that is a single layer, serving single layer that you can see the data from both the data warehouse, the Redshift data warehouse, and also S3 bucket for Redshift Spectrum that can be supporting on using external table. So what you see, what about the faster ingestion for real-time analytic, actually. So in this case, you replace your Kinesis firewalls with a Kinesis stream process, okay? And process your data into microbatch using Spark streaming, as you can see in this picture. And then you can perform an ETL job, so running Glue again, and push the data into Data Lake, and then here you have a Presto EMR that can running a regular job and then doing some federation query. So in this case, you can see, I can running a Presto EMR and then get data from, let's say, a Edgebase key value store that is streaming the data, and also from S3, and then I have federated query as a single serving layer. So moving on to the next classic question, which is about replacing your database replica with data lake. So in this case, we have many customers who want to take their data in their OLTP database, push them into S3, so using a service like Database Migration Services, DMS, and then have that act as a data set for your analytic tools. But there is a problem because, in database, there is many update and delete that create a new version of records. So those who have used database migration may have noticed, each row in the data is being migrated to S3. So has an additional column to indicate where it is an update or delete data. So let's say for a timestamp, for example. So it is a problem actually, because you have a multi-pair version of it. And so here again, you can deploy the same technique as I mentioned before, okay? So they can pushing the DMS data into tier one, okay? So and periodically, frequently, you can have a Glue ETL job that running merge the data, doing some merge between those rows that I want to take the latest version of the record, put them into a S3, and then serve it to the analytic tools again. Okay, so now again, in this case, you may have a problem because that is a grouping of records. So, in Vue, you can expensive operation because Vue is a very, very expensive operation. So over time, and this is a time is something that we have seen in the field, let's say on the aspect of consumption data. So how do we address that? So this is what you go through the same ETL processes, okay? So again, what you can do is digest your data into tier one, okay? So, and then put in tier two. And what you can do for you can additional doing that, you can do some daily snapshot of your data to preserve the database views of record. And this allow all the analytics tool to get a proper view from the record that at a certain time a day, okay? So let's switch to different kind of use case. Okay, so it's one of the common question that we get from most data scientists is how do I run my batch training pipeline with my data in data lake streamed and batch as well. So again, the process is very straightforward because you have your data sitting in your raw data arriving into tier one, okay? So like before, you can use either a Spark running or EMR or leverage a glue job to do your data preparation. Okay, so again, this data preparation could include feature extractions or transformation of the data, and you can put those process data into tier two, like before actually. So you can invoke another glue ETL job, and what it can do is provide the data to batch training job to Amazon SageMaker. So as you can see in this picture, and once the Amazon SageMaker is done building a model, it can push this model artifact to Amazon S3 artifact bucket. And another Python job for glue job can invoke SageMaker API to do a model deployment using the SageMaker hosting services. What about prediction on streaming data? This is very use case scenario. So in this real life scenario that we have seen with some of our customer, where they have a real event coming, it's from a web portal, for example, and they want to augment this data with some prediction for coming in for coming from SageMaker endpoint, as you can see in this picture. So in this case, the data can be streamed through Kinesis firewalls, okay, which is ingested with a Lambda function. And this Lambda function essentially augments your streaming data with prediction from a SageMaker endpoint and then deliver it to a S3 bucket. Okay, so, now this is a problem because it's a major problem, but it violates our first principle, which I showed you before. And this is a transformation. You can do it by running also a glue ETL with separate tiering and then running the separate tiering analytic for digesting the data and serve this data for the analytic tools. Okay, so all these design patterns kind of give us some foundation principle required to build a data lake. So, and this first principle is called the principle for minimal injection contacts. So what this means is that you need to decide as a data engineer of the owner of the data lake, for example, you need to decide on the location of the ingestion and select the frequency and injection mechanism to meet your SLA, for example. And the procedure of the data is given only the location on that S3 bucket, so on the prefix where they can, let's say, deposit their files. Okay, security and governance pattern. Let's talk about security. So AWS provides you with richest and most diverse portfolio of security compliance and governance focused services and features. So about 200 more significant services and feature focusing on that from services that help you establish and manage and federation identity, such as AWS Identity Access Management, IAM, KMS, ACM, etc. So you can find more details on all this on AWS website. But with that quick overview behind us, so let's focus on discussion a little bit about two key aspects of data that security relevant for data lake. So which is a data storage security and metadata security. So let's start data lake storage security. And so In this case, we have three key topics that we should consider when putting together a data lake storage security strategy. So the first one is that it's coming up from our customer to have multiple teams, want to access a single enterprise data lake. So the question is, how do you implement access control for those teams? We'll see that this is largely dependent on how you implement data and resource ownerships. And here we have a difference between two kinds of data and resource ownership. So this is a cross grain, which is responsible for the resource ownership, and the fine grain, which is responsible for the data ownership. The second short picture about how to implement fine-grained access control to Amazon S3, and we will talk about how to control the access to S3 from EMR and Redshift. So we also discuss a new excited feature about Amazon S3 that help you completely block public access to any Amazon S3 bucket in your AWS account. So, and finally, I will briefly give you an overview of encryption and encryption options that you can available for you. So in this strategy, so what happened is that teams share a fraction of resources, if you will. So you can take a look at the dash boundaries that we have in front of you. Is you can see that Team X is on a certain database and schema in Redshift cluster. So as you can see here in these pictures. Okay, so and does team Y, okay, have a both effectively share the same Redshift cluster, okay, as you can see here. So then we can have a similar situation with Amazon EMR cluster, as you can see on the right side. So the cluster we have a both team also shared the same cluster. So obviously this approach is advantage, and the biggest advantage is efficiency. Shared resources are better utilized, but you know, the same time and the trade-off of what you are going to make here, and is that access control will be now relative more complex, you know, to set up a maintain and the reason for that in that your EMR and Redshift. So both have their native identity management mechanism. So you have the ability to your identity structure in both of those clusters. Move on to metadata security, which is the other aspect of data lake security, and the metadata is really about your data set. It includes things such as mainly the schema that you overlay on top of your unstructured data on Amazon S3. So let's say if you have a CSV file, a JSON file, etc. So this includes things such as database definition, table definition, including column names, column type, and so on. And then AWS Glue provide you with a fully managed and persistent metadata store that you can use for your data lake. So this support for Hive Metastore compatibility. So you can use all of the Hadoop ecosystem tools that you are already familiar with, like Spark SQL, Apache Presto, Hive, and so on. And also Amazon AWS services such as Athena Glue, Amazon Redshift Spectrum, and then integrated with the Glue, all of them integrated with the Glue data catalog. So this represents a nice summary of capabilities of the different services, just to get a big picture view of that. So especially if I want to color the compliance for all of these services, so all these services are HIPAA eligible, and then FedRAMP compliance for EMR. But of course, we cannot include all of this compliance for those services. So here is your please visit AWS compliance website, and then make sure you can check how you can particular compliance regime that you are interested in. So let's talk about one of our customer, which is called Elminda. Okay, so Elminda is addressing the unmet needs for people suffering from brain-related disorder. So they develop a perfect technology that will reveal an individual unique brand function by creating objective measurement, so to bring a greater centrality to diagnostic of brand disorder and endurance, of course. And then they are enable better clinical decision making around the treatment. So they develop a technology which is called the BNA. So BNA is a brand network analytics, and they leverage machine learning, advanced algorithm, and large population of clinic data to provide a revolution of new way to understand how the brain neural networks are activated and inform about brain function. So all cloud and Elminda conduct an exploration process that include a lot of a meeting, a lot of brainstorm architectures and design review with Elminda key stakeholder, R&D department team, data scientist team, and DevOps teams, of course, to map the key consideration required for building an end-to-end data state for Elminda requirements, so which is a benefit and the current for all Elminda current in the current and the future's need. So they have three major data sources. The first one is the clinic data, okay, which is include data about patient visit, questionnaires, and study. So this data source include multiple clinic data sources from different countries, for example. A clinical data source, they have also questions like background disease. And the EEG data, another data source, okay, EEG data is a electrophysiological monitoring method to record the electrical activity of the brain. And then we also scan a medical document, okay? In this solution, we're using Amazon Comparend Medical, okay, which is an Amazon AI services. For unstructured, the clinical text, the physician note, the discharge summary, text result, use case, and case notes, sorry, and so on. Of course, this service are based on a natural language processes, which is an NLP technology. So here is the architecture. So let's talk about a few key considerations we are identifying during the meeting with Elminda staff. So they would like to launch this service in China, so which some AWS services have a limited availability. So as a result, the architecture is based on service available in AWS China. Elminda would like to keep its architecture, of course, cloud agnostics while having a cloud compatibility. So the services selected for the architecture include the code and technology that came easily. So it's easily, came easily and migrated to open source equivalent framework like, Lambda, the Python, Glue that can convert to Spark, and Athena that can be converted to Presto. So, and of course, the solution must comply with several industry standard compliance identified by Elminda, like HIPAA, FDA, and GDPR. Okay, so let's explain about the architecture. So, as you can see in this slide, so each data flow, data sources is ingested in the following manner. So, we have actually a few clinical data, and as you can see in the left side, okay. There is a daily CloudWatch trigger, okay, that which is start a step function as you can see here, okay, which is retrieve the data by accessing the data source API. The step function handles getting the data from multi-page studies as a pagination limitation of the data source and upload the data directly into raw data S3 bucket. Okay, so when the step function complete, getting the data from all the data. Okay, it's invoke a glue crawler, as I mentioned before. Okay, so this glue crawler is running, okay, and then what it does is map the schema for the raw data and they save it into AWS glue catalog. Okay, and then there is an ETL that job that's running on this and invoke a transformation. This ETL job, it's invoking transformation for raw data clinical data. Okay, and then put in the normalized format, as you can see here in this S3 bucket. And then after the job is complete, the transformation process invoke again a glue crawler, okay, which map the schema to the schema of the normalized data actually. So the caller again create a glue data catalog on both raw and normalized data bucket, which will be used to run a ad hoc query analytic via Athena Advanced Analytic, also using a Spark EMR cluster, and build a BI solution like a Tableau or Sizeland using 4-day analytics analyst. So, okay, and again, there is a data science team that use the Amazon SageMaker that they can directly interact with the data process to extract the feature for feature engineering, and from which is the data that's coming from normalized data bucket and bin machine learning algorithm, of course. Then we can see the EEG data devices, which is stream their scan data in near real time via Kinesis firewalls, okay, as data firewalls, as you can see here, directly into a S3 bucket. So during the scan, they're running a Spark streaming application on EMR cluster, and then they make sure. This is Spark EMR cluster. Then, they make sure that you can scan the quality and efficiency and notify the lab technically if there is any issue that they can raise a problem. And again, the last one actually is a medical document. Okay, so the Amazon Medical Comparator is part of the document and write to medical reachable format to a document and parse the document into the S3 bucket, as you can see here. Okay, so the glue ETL again is running the job. It's joining the data between the document for medical relevant clinical data and EEG data as inscribed in the previous flow. So let's go to the demo. I would like to show a very, very nice demo. So as you can see here, where is it? Okay. Okay, so this is, I bring a quick demo of that. So actually this data is not relevant for Allminder because it's a medical data and I can, you know, publish the data, this data on the, for this demo actually. So I take a very something that very similar to Kent bring you, explanation how you can use all those services that I talk about. So the first thing what I does is actually I take the Kinesis data generator, okay? This is a service that you can see, it's also in AWS services, and then stream this data into Kinesis firewalls. Okay, from this Kinesis firewalls, I digesting the data to S3 bucket, running the glue crawler. From the glue crawler, actually the data I save to data catalog. Okay, and then from that I run, this is actually the data catalog. Okay, and after I doing some transformation, I'm running again a glue crawler on that parquet data and save this data into Proceeds S3 bucket. And then I can use a SageMaker and then Glue for running a machine learning model. And then after that, I can use Athena for analyst and then using Amazon QuickSight to do some visualization. So all this GitHub repository, you can share with my repository, which is all with AVOs, okay? You can take it and there is a very, very clear explanation on how to use this this demo workshop. Okay, so let's start it. So the first thing that what we can see, then we can see the Kinesis Kinesis data generator. You have the CloudFormation stack that can you running on this demo. They can generate it for you. This Kinesis firewalls. What I did also, I created actually a delivery stream. Okay, for Kinesis firewalls. So sorry for the WhatsApp. Okay, and then what I can doing here, I can tell this data stream, let's say I want to say to send 200 event as message, and this is a kind of a code that I can generate a data. By the way, this data is a data relation between music tracking that people listening on the various activity they doing, like running, walking, etc. So this is data actually. This is kind of, and you can see an array of activity. And then now here I'm generating a data activity. So let's running this data. Okay, let's see what happened here. Okay, Oh, so sorry. My delivery stream is located on US East 1. Then you can see my delivery stream here. And then after that, I can send the data. So you can see the data is sending actually to firewalls. And we saw, as we saw in the architecture. So actually what's happened here, if I'm going to my S3 bucket, I can see this is the raw data. Okay, and this the raw data actually is partitioning to the data now I'm digesting to S3, okay? So as you can see in my delivery stream, I can see for the details that the data actually is serving to the data, raw data directory under my S3 bucket, okay? So as you can see, the data is streaming. Let's give us some more data to send it. So at this meantime, what happened that I creating actually a glue database. Okay, this is one part of the, that you can see, I can show you this in the webinar. So this is a database. In this, I'm using for this webinar, I created a database called the webinar DB. So this is a table that located for the glue data log, as I mentioned. We have three kind of table. Okay, where the process data, raw data, and reference data. Okay, the reference data, by the way, this is the track data for people listening. We can see this in Latina later. So after I created this data catalog, what can I do? I can go to my caller. Okay, so this is the caller. I have it, so I can run. Let's say go to the Kinesis delivery stream and I can stop sending data because it's sending too much data. So what can I do from that point? I can run my crawler, okay? So I can, sorry, not create a new crawler. Let's go back and go to choosing this and run crawler, not add crawler. So what happened here, that's actually, it's a, okay, so this is because I pressing it twice, and never mind that we can see in a few seconds, we'll see the current caller that is running, and there we is. So actually the caller is running. So what happened here? The data is calling to this table. In that case, we are going to talk about the raw data. So in calling tables, I can see my data, I can see my columns, I can see the partition key, I can see some summary data, important summary data for my data set. You can see the columns, of course, the record count, the average record size, and many, many interesting data to understand it, okay? So this is my caller, this is my data. So the thing is, what you can do, as you can see in Glue, you can create a glue job, okay? And then you create your transformation in Glue job. But what I did in this webinar, I created a dev endpoint. So dev endpoint, which is allow you to create a notebook. Okay, so when you create a dev endpoint, it asks you to create a Jupyter notebook. But this notebook actually is saved on a S3 bucket. This is my Jupyter notebook. Okay, it doesn't relate it to a SageMaker. Okay, it just give me a Jupyter notebook that I can use it from my Glue dev endpoint. Okay, so actually this is my notebook. Okay, I can open it, of course, when I click in here, but in this place, in that case, it's open here, so we can open this notebook. So let's say I already open, and this is actually the ETL that using the transformation. Okay, so what it does actually, it takes the raw data and the reference data, do some transformation doing between those data set, drop the irrelevant field, and finally create process data and save it in the new S3 bucket for a new analytics. So what you can see in this Jupyter notebook, you can see actually I'm bringing the relevant AWS libraries, okay? And then I'm starting a Spark application. And then I initiate a Glue context, which is a handle to my Spark context cluster behind the hood. And after that, I created a two data frame. Okay, this data frame, I'm using a form catalog, which I call this, if you remember what I'm doing here, I'm calling the database, which calls webinar for my Glue database. And this is my table from Glue data catalog. And again, from the reference data. So at this, I can see the view schema. I can see some count data. I can see my head top important tabular data also. and can do some SQL to some Spark SQL to explore the data, and can do some filtering, counting. Let's say this, I'm running a activity type. So what I'm doing here, I'm replacing my data frame to actually to view, and then I'm doing some Spark SQL on that view. Then I can see the data on SQL technique. So again, I can do a lot of computation. I do some very, very glue transformation, which is very, very unique for AWS glue. For example, if I want to do some analytic and do some filtering via glue, I can do some filter reply, and then I give you my data frame, and then I call this function that I created before, and then I get this result, okay? I can do a transformation and counting also by running a Lambda function, like Python Lambda function, which is very, very common also. I can do so joining two data frames. I can, again, use a glue transformation as a join operator and calling by both data frame. And this is the join key for these data frames. And then I can get a new data frame from here. And again, I can print the schema to see the metadata. I can do some cleaning data from my data frame because I don't want to see my partition data, partition column. So here I implemented a drop field method from glue transformation. And again, I send it the join data, I send the path of the column that I would like to drop, okay? And then after that, I can run again the print schema, getting all my relevant column that I would like to use, for example, for analytics or for data scientists, feature extraction. And then I can do some, again, if I want to do some data frame analytic, I can see this via data frame. And then I can do some final transformation, which is very, very important here. So what can I do here? I'm just taking I'm using here as a form option in dynamic glue data frame. So I take my join data clean. I tell him connect it to S3, take this path and save this data frame on S3, and then save this data as a Parquet format. Okay? So actually in that case, after I running this operation, I can go into my S3 bucket, okay? Let's go to my data folder, and then I can go to procedure data, and this is my Parquet data that generate from this command, okay? So what I can do from here, again, I can from my Jupyter notebook via BOTOS 3, okay, BOTOS 3 actually the SDK Python for AWS, so we can using a Glue client, okay, and I tell them which reason the Glue is located. I can connect it to my webinar crawler, okay, which I show you here in the AWS console, okay? And I tell him, okay, so start the crawling, okay? And what's happening actually is the same operation that I read when I choosing the crawler here, okay? I choose my crawler and I did this via AWS console. So this, of course, you can do this programmatically as you can see here. And after that, okay, what can I see here? I can do some running some metadata on my Glue catalog and to see, let's say my table on Glue catalog, okay? Again, I can do that via my Jupyter notebook. So actually this transformation, what it does is take the data that came from both raw data, do some transformation and all save all this data into three S3 bucket. Okay, so from that point, what I can do, I can connect it to my, I created, of course, and again, all this explanation on how to create the Athena and all this procedure, you can find in this GitHub repository. So what you can see here, actually, I can do some analytic on my data. For example, this is the data on the Ray data that I can running on Athena. For example, here, I do some... let's say on this query. Oh, again, so if you're moving the tab, the query is running. So don't do it, don't run this query again, because we can see there is a new few query here. Let's say, it's running this query again. Okay, so this is a raw data. I can see my raw data. I can running so counting by activity type. Okay, and again, here I can see which kind of tracking data I have. I have another data coming from the proceeds data. Okay, so here you can see the proceeds data that came from the two data frames, okay, the raw data and the reference data. Okay, so this is my data. Okay, so I can investigate it, analyze this data via Athena, and of course I can go to a QuickSight. I can manage the data by using a managed data set and then create a new data set. And then I connect it to my Athena analytic tools. As you can see, create new data set. I can create Athena. I can choose my webinar demo, create a data source. And then from that, I can choose my database, which is a webinar DB from Athena. Then I can choose my procedure data, for example, because this is data that move past the aggregation. So this directly query for your data. And then I can do some visualize. And from here, I can create a lot of very, very nice, useful visualization. So let's say I can take a heat map. I can choosing, let's say, artist name. So I can take a track name, and then I can see some data on this. So maybe I took a lot of data because I have a lot of data on my S3 bucket. But anyway, let's finish. Okay, this is the data. Okay, you can see the artist name, okay, and the amount of how many artist names is okay. I listened for that period of analytic, but you can do it a lot of analytics capabilities on Amazon a quick site. So let's go back to our presentation to continue.
We only have a few more minutes. So
I want to talk about a quick a new AWS service, which is called the Lake Formation. Okay, so Lake Formation is announced in reInvent in 2018. So Lake Formation is a service that help addressing some of this topic that we discussed. So for example, Lake Formation is a service that you can quickly build a data lake, so you can move and store catalog in a very simple way. So you can do it with a machine learning algorithm that can bring you a capability to do a quick data lake. So in the AWS console, as you can see, this is a step that you can create on AWS console. One is the ingest and register the data. So you can then doing some security and control of your data and collaborate which user can use on which data. And then finally, in the stage 4, you can do some monitoring and auditing. So with that, I'm finished. So thank you for listening. So now we are move to Q&A.
Yes, perfect. So I am sure that everyone has a lot of questions. I did see hands raised during the demo. So why don't we open it up for questions from the audience? I can narrate and you can answer. Does anyone have questions that they want to ask? Just gonna quickly look through these questions as they're coming in. So apologies, it'll just be one more minute. Let's give everyone a chance to ask. Okay, so first question. This is actually not about the demo like I thought. The first question is, how can you augment the data in your data lake with real-time predictions during ETL or integration?
So what you can do, as I mentioned in the use cases, you can actually streaming your data in the Kinesis stream, and then you can put it directly to streaming applications. So it's like a Spark application or Apache Flink if you work in this open source, and then you can consume this data and digest it to exactly for example to Kinesis analytics stream, that you can do some SQLite analytic, and then you can use this data and send it directly to S3 or to the specific data application or directly to some analytic tools like a database and something like that.
Okay, very interesting, thank you. Next question, how to enforce data protection rules in data lake?
So again, what you can do in this case, what you can do is actually is create a fine-grained access control for your user, okay? Create, let's say, for example, an authentication tools like a Cognito, Active Directory, whatever. And then you can give a fine-grained access layer to the S3 bucket for this specific user. And with the same time, you can a cross-grained access control that you can bring those permission for the customer that for the user that came from, let's say, Redshift, from EMR, or from Athena. And then you can, as I say, and I mentioned in the slide picture, you can share access between those analytics and user shares.
Okay, thank you. I'll take two final questions because that's all the time that we have. The first one is, how can you run machine learning training on data in the data lake?
Okay, so this is a very, very good question. So I think I mentioned something similar to before. So actually what you can do here, you can take actually, so again, the data from tier one, so running a Glue ETL job for preparation, and then you can do some running another ETL job that taking the data from the tier two and do some call to the Amazon SageMaker batch training process, and after this, a process is done, you can send the artifact model into S3 and then running Glue ETL to expose the model deployment.
Okay, thank you. And then one last question, the last question that came in, which new tools in context of Glue are targeted for ETL, serverless particularly? Are those notebooks, Lambda?
Yes, you can. Sorry, I didn't understand the question. Which notebook tools?
Which new tools specifically, okay, in the context of Glue are, yeah, targeted for ETL?
No. I didn't understand the question. Okay. What do you want to do with Glue, regard to Lambda and the?
Yeah. So this is a question that came in. It's not actually from me. It's from Yuri Polensky.
No problem. But just repeat the question because I didn't understand it clearly.
Okay. Which new tools in context of Glue are targeted for ETL?
Which new tools? Okay, can use, by the way, you can use step function as a workflow analytics, okay? You can use a kind of ETL that you have in the industry, like Airflow and a lot of solutions. But the step function actually is can do it for you the same job that you can do in Glue ETL. By the way, you can running Glue ETL job inside ETL job inside the step functions. This is a new feature.
I hope that answered your question, Yuri. All right. Do we have time for? He said it did answer his question. Thank you. Okay. So do we have time for one last question? I think so. What are the authentication and authorization options available?
So authentication and authorization, again, what you can do, using authorization like Cognito. So you can use Amazon Identity and Access Management. You can configure your key management system in order to authenticate the user that came, for example, for LDAP solution, and then can validate it and get this a certificate key using by AWS Certificate Manager to connect and process your data. So the solution for that is to using Amazon Cognito combines with Amazon Certificate Manager as well as IAM roles.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we had some great questions today. Can you move the slide forward, Oshik? Okay, so if anyone has more questions, then our blog, and it's on the All Cloud website. Obviously, like, you can go in there and you can read more about data, machine learning. There's a lot of content on there on those topics. We have a LinkedIn profile, which you are free to look at. And we make comments there on specifically these subjects. So Oshik has contributed in the past. Shlomi Itzhak, who heads up the data practice at All Cloud, has contributed. Data team has generously donated their time and knowledge. In addition, we have a business continuity response center specifically for times when we have to have webinars instead of meetups because of circumstances. So if you have any specific needs in regards to your cloud projects or your data projects, then please feel free to reach out at any time. And of course, we'll be sending out a recording of this a little bit later. So you'll have all these links. It doesn't just say link in there, there'll actually be a link. And we hope to see you soon on our next webinar. Thank you, everyone. Yes, we will submit the presentation. Yes. So we hope to see you on our next webinar, and thank you for joining. Bye, everyone.